I have so many good yogas in my horoscope. I have Raj Yogas, Mahapurush Yogas, Dharma Karmadipati Yoga. I have Virinchi Yoga. I have this yoga, that yoga. So many yogas. I have the bad yogas too. But why are my good or fancy yogas not giving any results? All right. So do you also have such bombastic, fancy yogas? And do you feel that you did not see any good result for these yogas? All right. So these yogas can include any yoga basically. And when I say yoga, I generally mean good yogas here. Or did you sometimes feel that you had some so-called terrible yogas, but they did not give you so bad results? So if you feel that you are in either of these two categories, then you are at the right place, because today we are going to discuss why do good yogas do not fructify or give good results as expected. And you can also take this one step further to judge why do so-called bad yogas or not so nice yogas don't give the worst results. All right. So therefore, if you are new to the channel, then please subscribe to it. And if you want a consultation from me regarding your good or bad yogas, or career, or marriage, or relationships, or health, or your spiritual life, you can always go down to the description section of my videos, where you'll find the link to my website. And yes, God is there with you all the time. Just look to Him and you will find Him. Okay, so what are yogas basically? We all know what yogas are. There are different kinds of yogas. So for example, if two planets are conjunct in a sign, then it's known as one form of yoga. Then there is exchange. Okay, so which means the third lord is in fifth and the fifth lord is in third. So that's known as Parivartan yoga. Then if you have two planets aspecting each other, okay, then also this is a yoga. So of course that's a separate topic on what is a yoga, and I already have a video on it, four kinds of yogas. Okay, so please watch it. So now the thing is, apart from this, there are many other categorization or different names of yogas. Like for example, there is Pancha Mahapurush Yoga. Then you have Dharma Karmadipati Yoga. Then you have Chamar Yoga. Then you have Akhanda Samrajya Yoga. There are many yogas actually. Okay, but why do you feel, or Raj Yogas in general? Okay, Raj Yoga means the lords of the Kendras and the Trikonas are somehow linked. Okay, they are in yoga basically. So that's known as a Raj Yoga. So even Mahapurush Yogas, when planets except Sun, Moon, Rahu, Ketu, all the remaining five planets, they are sitting in Kendra 1, 4, 7, 10, condition number one, and they are either in own sign, Mool Trikon, or exaltation, either of these three, then Mahapurush Yogas are formed. But you will see many, many, many people. Now, when you are beginning astrology, then you may start jumping when you see Mahapurush Yogas or Raj Yogas. But you will realize as you keep moving ahead in your journey of astrology, you will see thousands of horoscopes, especially when you are doing consultations. So then you won't be charmed by these yogas anymore. But why? Does it mean that these yogas do not work? Or Parashara has written some, he has just written some bluff, you know, some exaggeration. No, it is not like that. But the problem is we do not interpret the things in the right context, and we do not know the base behind everything. So either you, any yoga you want to judge, you must follow certain principles. Without that, if you judge the yogas individually, you will end up making the worst predictions. Okay, or even if you don't make predictions, your understanding of the chart will be horrible actually. You won't get any understanding. All right, so what are those principles which you should take into consideration? So there are many principles. There are thousands of principles which are there, and I cannot mention all of these. I will mention some of these. And in the meantime, if you are watching this video, you can also write below in the comments which special yogas do you have, which you are aware of, that they are known as some special yogas, and what kind of results have you seen in their mahadashas or antardashas? Okay, because the results of the yogas will come in the dashas of either of the planets. Okay, so suppose your ninth lord is in 10th and 10th lord is in 9th, then when the dasha of the ninth lord or the 10th lord is there, antardasha or mahadasha, then you will see the results. Okay, so I want to know which are the planets that are giving you Rajyogas and what kind of results have you faced, okay? Have you seen? Have you seen very good results or very bad results or no special results at all? Okay, so what is the first principle that you should take into consideration? The first principle is you must check the sun and moon, all right? These two are luminaries. These two are very, very, very crucial. They are the most important planets in the chart. Okay, so when you see the strength of these two, so suppose your sun is well placed and then your moon is well placed, then this chart is by default a very elevated chart. So therefore, even if this person does not have, because see, sun and moon, they represent your connection with yourself, not with the world, your connection with yourself. How much can you do what you want to do? What you do is the sun and what you want to do is the moon. So how are sun and moon placed? Are you able to do what you want to do in life? Do you have a goal? Do you have a focus, or you are headless? You're just roaming. You may be doing so many things. You may be married. You may have kids. You may have a career, but you may be still headless. You don't know what you are doing in this. I mean, you may have $1 million business. You may still be headless. Okay. Or you may be doing a lot of spiritual practices also. Even then you may be headless. Okay. So therefore, you have to ask this question to yourself, that to what extent is there harmony between anything, not only material or spiritual, anything in matters of health? How much are you eating right? How much are you sleeping on time? Are you leading a good lifestyle, basically? All right. Sun and moon are very crucial. Then you have to see the ascendant. Ascendant, not the ascendant lord. That is next step. Ascendant, you must check. Okay. So if the ascendant is having good planets means either natural benefics like Jupiter, Moon, Mercury, Venus. You could include Sun also in this, because Sun in the ascendant gives a lot of vitality and strength and vigor. Or even if they are malefics, but if they are trinal lords, okay. So if you are a Capricorn Lagna and you have Shani in Lagna, so Shani is your Lagnesh in Lagna, okay. Or you are a Taurus Lagna, Shani is your Yog Karak and he is sitting in Lagna. So even if he is a malefic, but he is auspicious for you, event wise, okay. He is auspicious, not surrounding wise, event wise, which means he will give you good events, okay. But the surroundings may not be there that great. Because he's Shani after all. Saturn can never become Jupiter. Alright, so you check the ascendant, or the ascendant is being aspected by a natural benefic. Alright, so suppose you have Jupiter in trines, and then Jupiter, if it is in trines, then it will always aspect the ascendant. Alright, or do you have malefics aspecting the ascendant? Okay, like Mars, Saturn, Rahu, Ketu. Unless Mars and Saturn are ruling a trine, okay, fifth or ninth. If they are not, then they are not auspicious for you, okay? I mean, when it comes to judging the ascendant, they are not auspicious for you, okay? So then if you have these malefics, these four malefics primarily, Saturn, Rahu, Ketu, Mars, if they are linked with your ascendant, then it might happen that you are not able to utilize the yogas properly, because Mars will give you anxiety and Saturn gives you pessimism. Ketu gives you headlessness and Rahu gives you obsession. So what happens when you are headless, Ketu? Okay, then you don't know how, what you should do with this. Okay, then if Saturn is linked, then it can happen that you get opportunities. Suppose the 10th house is great, so you get a lot of work opportunities, but then you feel that, oh, I don't know how to proceed in this line, or what should I do, or should I deserve this, or should I take it up, or should I just leave it? So Saturn can give you pessimism at times, okay, unless it is a trinal lord, I repeat. And Mars can give you anxiety. Oh, will I be able to maintain it? What if somebody steals it? I got a promotion. What if my colleague, my competitor steals my position? Okay, so Mars gives you anxiety. And then Rahu. Rahu is like, oh, yes, I have got it. Now I don't have to do anything in life. I'm done for the rest of my life, okay? And I am the king here. I will force everybody to listen to me. So that is also not good. So these kind of things can be there. So then the next point is you have to judge the ascendant lord. Where is the ascendant lord going? The ascendant lord, is it exalted? It is in nobility or in enemy sign or friend sign, or how is it actually, okay? Is it linked with the trines? Is it in a kendra or in a trikon? Where is it? What is it doing? Is it helping the horoscope? All right. So this is very important actually, because the ascendant lord will show your focus. Where are you physically going? Ascendant lord's placement will tell you what affects you the most. Okay. What affects you the most? So therefore, the ascendant lord is very crucial. So now you have checked all this. You have checked sun, moon, then you have checked your ascendant, then you have checked your ascendant lord. Okay. So by seeing these, you will get an idea of what is the strength of the chart. These are the pillars of the horoscope. If they are good, then the chart is good. Doesn't matter. I don't give a damn about any fancy yoga that you have. If you have these planets good, your chart is good. You are a strong person. You are a good person. Okay. Then the next point, which is also very crucial, is the trinal lords, the lord of the fifth and the ninth, where are they placed? Okay. So are the fifth lord and the ninth lord, are these two well placed? Or they are having some yoga with the ascendant or sun, moon or ascendant lord. Even then, this is very auspicious. Okay. Even if they are malefics and they are having yoga with the ascendant or with the ascendant lord, they are still auspicious. Okay. So, for example, if a Leo Lagna person has Mars in Lagna, that's very auspicious, okay? Because Mars is a Yog Karak and it is also it's a trinal lord, of course. That's why it's a Yog Karak, okay? So, therefore, Mars is a very important planet for Leo Lagna, okay? So, don't think that it's a malefic, okay? Now, of course, Mars in Lagna for a Leo Lagna will give some level of anxiety because it is Mars. Okay, Mars can never become Venus. But because it's a Yog Karak, externally it will provide you opportunities and positivity. Okay, but still the anxiety will be there because it's a natural malefic after all. Just like, as I said, for Saturn. Okay, so you have seen all these yogas. First you saw the fancy yogas, which is actually the thing we should do at the last. Okay, so then you see this is the first part. First you judge all these factors and analyze how strong the horoscope is, how good, how much power is there in the horoscope. Okay. Power doesn't mean to make money or to become world famous. That's not power. I mean, that is a form of power that happens when a 10th house is in. But power means ability to go ahead in life. Okay, so when you have seen all this, then you have to see which are the prominent areas in his horoscope. So where is the Lagnesh? Where is the sun? Where is sun, moon? Which planets are linked to the ascendant? So you have to identify the prominent areas of the horoscope. So suppose somebody is 2nd, 7th and 11th houses are very prominent. Okay, so that they have prominent placements here, or their lords are in prominent positions. And then if you have the 10th house, if you have a yoga in the 10th house, okay. Now 10th house is a negating house for marriage because it's the 12th from the 11th house. So now this is like saying, you have a Raj Yoga in the 10th house and your prime focus in life is your family and your marriage. Okay. But then this 10th house yoga has become activated. So you might feel this yoga has become a distraction and a curse for you. Yes, you might feel like this. Even though this yoga is active, or you may not be very much interested in using that yoga. Okay. Why? Because your focus is somewhere else. All right. So no, it doesn't mean that the yoga is useless or the yoga is not working, but your focus is somewhere else. That is why you are not feeling as if this yoga is working for you, even if it is actually. So this is something which you have to understand. On the contrary, if you have majority planets or very prominent positions of the 2nd, 6th, 10th and 11th, because these four are the houses of money and finances and career, name, fame, status, power, position, authority. Then suppose if you have a Raj Yoga in the 7th house, then that can be like distraction. because your marriage may become too much demanding. Okay, so then you might feel that you are not able to work properly in your career, and this some astrologer has told you, oh, you have this, you know, big Raj Yoga in 7th house, this will happen, that will happen after marriage. Actually, it's happening, but because your focus is somewhere else, you are feeling as if it's a distraction, it's a curse actually. All right, so therefore you have to analyze where is the flow of the chart, what is the focus of the person. If you cannot identify the focus of the person, you cannot give a good consultation. It is simply not possible, because when you are giving consultation to somebody, you must be able to summarize. At least this is what I try to do. Of course, you cannot do it every time, and not that everybody will ask you this question, but when you are doing a consultation, especially a full consultation where the person wants overall guidance in his or her life, then you must be able to summarize 3 to 4 areas of their life. You must tell them that these 3-4 areas will be your focus. Okay, your life will rotate, revolve, reverberate around these areas. You must be able to identify that. Because once you tell them these 4 areas, then they will know, okay, so this is like the Kendra Bindu of my life. This is like the center of my life. My life will rotate around this. So then they can make plans accordingly, okay? Apart from telling that, you can, if you keep saying, oh, you have Venus in 10th house, you will go on selling perfumes. It doesn't work, all right? Because many people may have Venus in 10th. A person may sell embroidery, a person may sell perfumes, a person may be a movie star, a person may be a YouTuber. So anything can happen, all right? But it is your duty to identify what are the focus areas of a person's life, okay? At least 3 to 4 areas, or even if you feel there is only one focus, you must tell them, okay? Or if you see there are too many, you should narrow it down to 3 or 4. So that, and you should try to identify which areas within his focus areas, which will give him the highest level of happiness in life, okay? That you must be able to tell. Otherwise, what will happen is, you just confuse your client and he will just roam headlessly after the consultation, all right? So once you identify the focus, then you see how are these individual yogas helping, okay? And now the most important thing which I would like to say at the end is, the yogas which you see, they have to be judged from the bhava chart, okay? So which means, suppose you have Mars in Aries, okay? If you have it in first house, suppose you are Aries Lagna with Mars in Aries. But suppose in your bhava chart, your Mars is in the 12th house, okay? It can happen. Then there is no Ruchak Mahapurush Yoga, because now Mars will not give results of the Lagna alone, or I mean, depending on the lordship in the bhava chart, because sometimes the lordships also change in the bhava chart apart from the placements, okay? So if Mars is in the 12th house in your bhava chart, you may not experience Ruchak Mahapurush Yoga. Okay, so similarly, you might not similarly, suppose you have 2 planets conjunct. So suppose you are a Scorpio Lagna, and moon, sun and moon, they are your 9th and 10th lords. Okay, sun is your 10th lord, moon is your 9th lord. And if suppose they are conjunct in a particular Rashi, okay, in the Rashi chart, so then you may think, oh, I have Dharma Karma Adhipati Yoga. But suppose the moon is in a previous house in the Bhava chart, then it is actually, although degreeically it is in the same zodiac sign, but because it's in a different house, it will not give results of that house. It will give results of the house where he is sitting, the previous house, okay? So then you may not experience Dharma Karma Adhipati Yoga, okay? And yeah, so these are principles which you need to take care. So otherwise, you will make serious blunders, okay? Therefore, when you are doing a consultation, make sure you check sun, moon, ascendant lord, the trinal lords. Then you see the overall flow of the chart, the focus areas of the person. And then you see, are these yogas there in the bhava chart or only there in the rashi chart, okay? And once you see that, then you will understand, will these good yogas fructify or they will not, all right? Because many times it can happen, you have a bad yoga in your 12th house, okay? But suppose in your bhava chart, this yoga is, you know, 11th house. Wow, great money you will get. Okay, so that's the catch, you see, bhava chart. All right, don't miss the bhava chart. Okay. All right, thank you very much. And if you are new to the channel, then please subscribe to it. And if you want a consultation from me regarding your yogas or any other area of your life, then you can always go down to the description section of my videos, where you will find the link to my website to book a consultation with me. And yes, God is there with you all the time. Just look to Him and you will find Him.